Ladies and gentlemen, to introduce tonight's act, from Stars in Their Eyes, Mr. Matthew Kelly.
He is the creator of the most successful British comedy of all time. He is Hollywood's hottest Brit, with shows on three American networks and more appearances on Letterman than any other comedian. He holds the world record for internet downloads. He has sold 5 million DVDs worldwide and is the only British performer to write and star in The Simpsons. He has won an Emmy, 2 Golden Globes and 6 BAFTAs, and now has the fastest selling live tour in history. So who are you going to be for us tonight?
Tonight, Matthew, I'm going to be Ricky Gervais.
So now I'm Dangerous, Mr. Midas himself, the Potfather, the phenomenon that is the King of Comedy, Ricky
Thank you. Not too over the top, is it? Spent the entire budget on that. Just me and a microphone now. Look, not even a coat hook. Unbelievable. Oh. Some comedians have a stall out on stage for their drink or whatever. No. One of the awards there. Not the real thing, a much bigger version of the real thing. It's, I don't want you to think I'm a dwarf. Nothing wrong with dwarfs. I'm just not one. People go, oh, you can't have a go at dwarfs. You can, that's what you can have a go at them, really. Fundamentalist terrorists I stay away from. Dwarfs, what are they gonna do? What an amazing welcome. It's fantastic to be in London. As far as I'm concerned, the tour starts now. So thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you. Well, I say the tour starts, apart from Scotland and Brighton and Birmingham. I did a few charity gigs in the year to warm up. I know what you're thinking straight away. Ricky Gervais, are you still doing stuff for charity? Shut up. What? You do too much. I don't. What? How much did I raise for cancer alone last year? It doesn't matter, mate. It doesn't. Give us a ballpark figure. Ooh. Millions. It was millions. And they're welcome to it. But I will say this. If I ever get cancer myself, I'm going to go into the nearest hospital and go, right, I paid for that machine. Get that little bald fucker off it. Talking of little bald fuckers, I did the teenage cancer gig. Like, what? At the Albert Hall. Last year. I'd done it 2 years before as well. I did it in 2004, but they called again last year. We're still ill. You lasted. I mean, so. No, it's a great gig, and the kids with cancer are getting free and everything. And you meet them afterwards and stuff. And I was doing the gig this last time, last year, and I looked down and I recognised one of them. I thought, oh yeah, he came backstage. 2 years ago, he was telling me about his illness, and he said he was 18. And that was then, that was 2 years ago, so now he must be 20. So why the fuck is he still a teenager? Do you know what I mean? Lying little shit. He wasn't lying about the cancer, he was riddled with it. It hurt him to laugh, but he shouldn't be. And I was doing the gig, and he was laughing along, and I was thinking, yeah, you laugh it up, mate. I was fuming. And it got too much for me. I'm human. So I went, all right, mate, I recognise you. Went, came backstage 2 years ago. I went, yeah. He said, you're 18 then. Went, yeah, so you're 20 now. He went, yeah. I said, get out. Get out. I called the security. He struggled, but he was weak. They'd worked out. You could see they... Although they had trouble getting hold of him to start with, and then they got him in a... No. And his drip nearly had someone's eye out. I go, get him out. The crowd started booing. I went, hear that? They don't want to see someone like you take the piss out of me.
No, it's a great gig, and it is at the Albert Hall, home to Hitler's other testicle. Hitler has only got one ball. The other is in the Albert Hall. I didn't see it, and I looked around for it, which is suspicious. If I had that, I'd have it in the foyer. On a plinth in a glass cabinet.
In an egg cup.
I'd love to look at that. Not in a gay way. I wouldn't be going, oh, there's a lovely bit of old bollock. I'd be going, that's the physical and symbolic embodiment of pure evil. That's Hitler's seed. Hitler has only got one ball. The other is in the Albert Hall. His mother has got the other. What, did he have three? It doesn't make any sense at all. And why would she have that? Why would your mother keep that, really? Unless she's going, look, he's my son and I love him, but he's a wrong'un. I know it. I don't want him breeding. I'm keeping back Hitler's testicle. Well, she wouldn't say, she'd say my Adolf's, wouldn't she? That name's died out, hasn't it? No one's calling a kid Adolf. There's no little Adolfs. I don't know anyone who's got a, what's it, Adolf. I don't. No little kids go into school. Loads of Robbies and Kylies, but you don't hear the teacher doing the register. You know, Brittany here, Justin here, Adolf here. You don't. Fascinating fact about Hitler. People always learn stuff from my lectures. No. He got his image from Charlie Chaplin. Sounds like a joke, absolutely true. Chaplin had that little moustache first, and he loved him. He absolutely loved Chaplin. He had his films flown in from Hollywood. He watched The Great Dictator twice, even though it was dissing him. He loved it. And I always wondered why, through history, only two people had those silly little half moustaches. He got it from him. And I think of the day he had that done and went to see his generals, as usual, Goebbels, Goering, Himmler, and he goes, all right. What? I've shaved the sides off a bit, innit? Why? Be like Charlie Chaplin? The comedian? Are you thinking of doing comedy?
I was!
Really?
Yeah, why not?
Well, we don't find you funny.
Careful.
Cheers. I did a big charity gig in New York last year for autism. And like most people, my only experience of autism until recently was Dustin Hoffman's brilliant portrayal in Rain Man. But I've just got a new house, and the neighbours were coming round and poking their noses in. We're doing some building work, and we need planning permission, so we're being nice to them for now, and then they can fuck off.
Big gate.
Fuck off. One couple's got an autistic son, and the mother was talking to me. She said, oh, this is Douglas, he's 17. He hasn't got any friends because he never goes out. And I, so creeping, I said, well, I'll take him out. She went, really? Went, yeah, so I went back on the Saturday and she went, oh, he loves the zoo. And the zoo's only about a mile from this new house. So I'm walking down the street with Douglas and he's like this. He doesn't take his eyes off his mum all the way down. He's like that, all the way down. And she's in the doorway and she's waving back at him and she's crying. And eventually she sort of goes in and shuts the door and I hailed a cab and said, right, take us to the casino.
You've got to make it work for you, haven't you? So, not going to be a completely wasted day. Do you know what I mean? So,
and I can sign one person in, so I signed him in. He had a little suit on and everything. I think it's going to be brilliant. So, I went straight to the blackjack table. That's their best one, I think. I'm not a doctor, but I think that's... I love that, I love that. I said, OK, Dougie, you know the score. Bet two for good and one for bad. Do you understand? He went, yeah. I went, brilliant. I'll bet a grand down in half hour. I went, Dougie, do that thing, count the cards, know what good cards come, remember all the cards, that, do that thing, whatever it is, right? And tell me to bet two for good one. He went, yeah, yeah, yeah. Another grand down. I thought, what sort of an autistic... So I was confused. I threw some toothpicks on the carpet. I said, how many? He went, I don't know. I said, there's seven. I can see the seven from here. Waste of...
So I took him back home, went to the mother, there's been a mistake. It's... He walks like Rain Man, but he's got none of that clever shit. We're building a swimming pool, live with it. Do you know what I mean? So they better give us planning permission. If they don't, I'm going to keep the house, but I'm going to rent it out for a quid a week to some crackheads. How would you like them as neighbours? One of the few pleasures of fame is that you can do good things, but in all honesty, I think some causes are more worthy than others. Joking aside, cancer's a very worthy cause. Autism's a very worthy cause. But I got asked to do a benefit gig recently for sufferers of obesity. What? What? She went, sufferers of obesity. I went, you mean fat people? She went, no, because obesity is... Well, actually, she actually went, no, because obesity... She was eating, of course she was eating. She was eating. She's, no, she's good. She's good. She was peckish between snacks and, no. But she said, obesity is a disease. No, it's not, is it? You just like eating, don't you? No, it's not, is it? Oh, is that a disease? Oh, I'm so fucking ill. Oh, I'm well ill. I'm really ill. I said to her, what's the disease? She went, everything tastes good. Everything? Yeah, not salads. Salads. Oh, it's not a disease, is it? Leprosy is a disease. Can you imagine Jesus in the temple? People come up to him in bandages going, Jesus, my face is falling off. Can't stop now, it's a fat bird in a third pie. They eat too much. That's what does it. Simple science. But they complain, don't they, fat people? They complain about the situation. They go, no. Oh, I'm getting fat. Aeroplane seats. They're not big enough for someone like me. No, they're not. Because if they were, we'd only get 12 fucking people on the plane. Unbelievable. It's not fair. It is fair. That's what happens. And if we're talking about fairness and aeroplanes, why is it I get the same luggage allowance as a bloke who's 40 stone? Why is that allowed? We're both allowed 32 kilograms on the plane. I want to go, no, he used up his 32 kilograms on his tits. It's not a disease. I saw a documentary about a woman who was 28 stone, right? Because she ate 10 pie and chips a day. That'll do it. Mm. 10 separate meals of pie and chips. That's all she ate. 10 separate trips to the chip shop. In a cab. Didn't even walk that. Wasted calories. So they wired her jaw together. So she liquidized 10 pie and chips a day. Now she's on pie smoothies. Now she's not even chewing. That used up 5 calories. Do you know what I mean? So she gets fatter. They take her to hospital to have that operation where they staple your stomach together. And she's sitting in the hospital looking all depressed. Well, you can't eat for an hour before an operation, can you? And she went, it's a really dangerous procedure, but it's the only option left. One, jogging? You don't even walk. Salads? You don't like the taste. Right. 9 pie and chips a day? It's a start, isn't it? It's a starter to her. I'm not having a go. I'm a bit overweight myself. The other night someone shouted, no shit. Oh. I thought, could be that. That'd be great, wouldn't it? You go to the doctor, he goes, no, you're not fat, you're constipated. I had to go to the doctor to have a medical for this tour. I've had medicals before for TV work. They check your pulse and go, yeah, fine, you're not going to die in the next 3 weeks. But I always think, what if I fail the medical? What if they say, no, you're not fit enough. You can't do the TV work. Then I see Johnny Vegas on telly and I think, I'm all right. Do you know what I mean? He's like my canary down the mine. If I'm in a restaurant, I go, do you want a pudding? I go, is Johnny Vegas still alive? I go, yeah. I go, bring it on. Okay, now. So I went along to Harley Street, and the doctor said, it's a bit more thorough than usual. Yeah, it's a big tour. So we need a urine sample. I went, fine, yeah. So he gave me the little thing in the bag to put it in. Did that, came back to him, good as gold. He went, oh, can you strip down to your boxer shorts? I thought, this is thorough. I don't have to do that before. But I stripped down to my boxer shorts. Oh, for fuck's sake. The one day I wear white boxer shorts. Big wet patch from the wee. Why didn't he warn me? Why didn't he say, be careful, I'll be checking your pants in a minute? He's, you know, and there's nothing I could do. I just stood there and it was one of those pairs just had a slit and I tried to sort of pull it over and it pinged back and he saw it. I saw the moment he saw it. There's nothing I could do. And I was thinking, oh, sorry, he's a doctor, he can't tell anyone. And then I thought, if I was a doctor, I'd tell everyone everything. I would. I'd come and go, you'll never guess what I found up an arse today. So I thought, oh, I'm just gonna tell everyone. And I had to touch my toes as well, which sounds all right in front of a doctor, but it's still a man you haven't met before in pants that you've wet. So you feel really vulnerable and just... And you try and make everything look okay in the doctors, don't you? They go, does that hurt? Definitely not. Definitely not. Touch your toes, easy, right? And the truth is, I've got to that age where I have to make a sort of noise to get me up and down now. Do you know what I mean? That didn't happen in your 20s. 20s, bang. 30s, bang. 40s, you go... Why do you do that? I think it's a warning to family and friends that they hear that and go, oh, granddad's bending over. And he's up, on with the barbecue. But things happen with age. But it's good and bad. I'm at that age now where it's totally acceptable for me to back in a lorry driver I've never met before. Do you know what I mean? If you're 20 and really skinny, they go, fuck off, mate. But I can go, you're all right. Go on, whoa! Be careful, Plod's around the corner. Do you do that? Do you sort of be a bit more working class, a bit tougher with, like, people in boiler suits? All right, mate, yeah, not too bad, yeah. Do you want a cup of fucking tea? Like that. Anyway, I wet myself, good. After I came back, I told my friend about the wee incident, and my friend went, oh, you should have gone commando. What? That would have been less embarrassing, wouldn't it? So now I look down, I think, oh, I've wet myself, what can I do? Oh, I know, they're coming off too. That's as dry as a bone, Doc. Should have gone commando. Do commandos not wear pants? Why is it called? They must wear pants, don't they? What? I'm a commando and I'm wearing pants. I've never heard that phrase before. I've never heard that phrase. They're gonna see that. Should have gone commando. But I am a little bit overweight myself, and I never worried about it before I was famous, and I'm not vainer now. It's that you read about yourself and the papers need an adjective. They can't just say, Ricky Gervais, comedian. They say things like, Ricky Gervais, tubby comedian. Why say that? Why? Don't give them clues. Let them make their own minds up. One said, rotund comic. Rotund? That's like a giant wombat. I'm not rotund. I've been referred to as a chubby funster. That's a gay porn star, isn't it? It's me, the chubby funster. I was jogging once with my iPod. Yeah, looking good. Paparazzi got me. Full page in the Sun the next day with the headline, iPodge, you. Cheeky bastards. Dawn French has had a go at my weight. What? Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. French and Saunders Christmas special last year. I love French and Saunders. I think they're great. I've liked them for a long time. I think they're really good performers. And I was watching this at home. Sketch comes on. Bubbly Dawn knocking on the door of a house. Inside is Jennifer going, "Who is it, please? Yes, who is it, please? It's me. Who's me? Me, the little fat one with a big ego." She opens the door. "Oh, I thought you meant Ricky Gervais." Good gag. No, it is a good gag. If you hand it out, you've got to take it. Comedians have a go, you know, it's just fine. And she's putting herself down. She's lumping us both in. You know what I mean? She's saying, we both got egos. We probably have got egos. We're performers. Although, if Dawn was here, you wouldn't be able to see that. I'm joking. I'm joking. I'm joking. You'd be able to see some of it, wouldn't you? But it would spell Roy. Oh, dear. She started it. No. No, she's putting us both down. She's going, "We've both got egos and we're both fat." And we are both fat. Different categories, though, isn't there? There's different... different weight classes. Do you know what I mean? Doesn't tell the whole story. On a scale of too thin, thin, average, bit fat, me, Dawn. She started it. It's not a disease. Therefore, it's not a worthy cause. Talking of which, saw someone collecting the other day for ME. Not MS, not the crippling wasting disease. Oh no, ME. That's the one where don't feel like going to work today. Oh, ME. I apologise to anyone who suffers from ME. You're not going to have a go, are you? Oh. No, no. I do apologise because I've since learnt that it is a real disease. I thought it was psychosomatic, but it's physiological. And it's a very misunderstood disease as well, so it's easy to ridicule it. I suppose it's because the symptoms aren't apparent. It's not like losing a limb. They go, "We're tired," and we go, "Well, how do we know that?" And it sounds like a mollycoddling society that accepts this new disease that wasn't around 100 years ago. You know, you don't see it in third world countries. You'd never hear a starving African complaining about having ME. Do you know what I mean? Sucky. Walk to the well. This is not racist, okay? I don't want to have my perfume contract taken away like Jade Goody. It got madder and madder, didn't it, that Celebrity Big Brother? I mean, it started off well. Opening night, H from Steps comes out as gay, and we're all meant to go, "You're joking." His name's Ian Watkins. Where's the H? All these years, that must have just stood for homosexual. He was trying to give us clues, wasn't he? He was trying to come out. Or, what's your name? Or just call me H. It's not racist. Sucky. What? Delicate stuff, this. One false move and I'm Jim Davidson. Right. Relax, I know what I'm doing. It's the accent, isn't it? That we're, and I'm not very good at accents either. I'm trying to do Nelson Mandela. So I'll give it a bit of dignity. He's sort of, he's sort of high, isn't he? So he says things like, Winnie, what are you burying in the garden? It's not racist, it's fine, isn't that? It's an impression. People are very worried about that, aren't they? They go, "Oh, is that racist? Can you say that? Well, we've taken the wrong way," particularly this year, because it's 200 years since the abolition of slavery, so awareness is heightened. But that wasn't the end of racism. It was still inherent in society as late as the 50s and 60s in England and America. And one incident sparked off the civil rights movement. A black woman called Rosa Parks refused to give up her seat to a white person on a bus. It was the law, but she'd had enough, and she was arrested. But then that law was changed. But she didn't stop there. She started sitting in those seats meant for disabled people. Unbelievable. She talked to the driver when the bus was in motion. Did she always have the correct change ready? Did she bollocks? What was her problem?
Sucky.
They're starving. I've forgotten the point of this. Oh, I'm here.
Sucky.
Walk many miles to the well.
That was all right. That wasn't too bad. Fuck off, six BAFTAs. Thank you. It's actually seven. Oh, I forgot. Who's counting? I am.
Sucky, walk many miles to the well and fetch the water and come back. That was Yorkshire. What the fuck am I doing?
I don't know. Shush. Right. It's not worth it. Right. Just... Oh, Sucky, I'm reet parched. Go to well with it.
Oh, Sucky. Sucky. Sucky, my daughter. Walk many miles to the well. Sucky, walk to the well.
He's trying to be casual, like it's no big thing. He doesn't know anything wrong, isn't he? It's just a normal day.
Sucky, walk to the well and fetch the water and come back.
Oh, fuck that.
Why is it that word? Sucky, Sucky. Oh, fucking hell. Sucky, walk to the well and fetch the water and bring it back. So...
Whoa, shut up, that was all right. Fucking hell. Oh, Jesus Christ. Right.
Sucky, walk to the well and fetch the water and bring it back to mash the grain. But, Father, I cannot walk to the well and fetch the water and bring it back to mash the grain. Sucky, why can't you walk to the well and fetch the water and bring it back to mash the grain? Emmy.
I told you it wasn't worth it. Oh, thank you very much. Oh, the funny side of famine. Cheers. I did do charity work before I was famous. When I worked at the Students' Union, the University of London, one of the first big charities I got involved with was the Terence Higgins Trust, the big AIDS charity. And it was mid to late 80s, and people were like, what's this new thing called AIDS? What is... I mean, it's gone from strength to strength now. It's doing brilliantly. It's gone global. Doing very... So got its own day and everything. 1st of December, World AIDS Day. I don't think it'll ever pick up like Christmas. We don't do anything in our house. There's no decorations. But I discovered something. You're still learning. The first HIV virus was a combination of two separate viruses that combined in rhesus monkeys and it made this rudimentary form of AIDS. And it was fatal to them, but this was passed to chimpanzees. Sometimes chimps would get a bloodlust and eat a rhesus monkey. And it evolved and mutated in chimps. And because we're 98.6% genetically identical to a chimpanzee, it was able to be passed to humans. And the first human contracted AIDS when he was chopping up chimp meat and cut his finger. Although that's the excuse I'd have given. You'd have to come up with something, wouldn't you? You go to the doctor and you go, oh, I feel terrible, doc. Doctor goes, well, I'm not surprised. You go, is it ME? Worse than ME. You wish you had ME. You shouldn't be laughing about it. He's got terrible news. No, terrible doctor. Anyway, you're the first human to contract AIDS. Is that bad? Can be. Still laughing. You should be. How would I have got that? Two ways. One, you were fucking a chimp up the arse. Fucking a chimp up the arse, me? No way. How else could I have got it? Oh, I don't know, you could have been chopping a chimp up, cut your finger, that one. Chop, choppy, chimpy finger, one. I bet he went straight out into the jungle and found that chimp and went, you gave me AIDS. Oh, what?
You gave me AIDS. I gave you a blowjob. Shush. No, I got AIDS from you. Well, where did I get AIDS from? From eating monkeys. I don't eat monkeys. You're either eating them or fucking them. I was eating them. That's how it happened. Always learning. Global warming. That's the big one. That's the one they're trying to get celebrities to endorse. And it is the big one, I suppose. It's the end of the world, but it can bring brilliant weather to England. Serious point, though, isn't it? How'd you go to Bob in Yorkshire? He's had a lovely summer. He's playing cricket and barbecuing. And you go, it's all got to stop, Bob. All got to stop. You can't drive your car anymore. You can't use aerosols because you'll eventually stress out some Eskimo. He's not going to give a fuck, is he? Sorry, that's racist. Oh, sorry. I don't know what's come over me tonight. I'm really sorry. You can't say Eskimo anymore. They want to be called Inuits. So, I don't know who's complaining. You live in snow. Who's going, oh, Gervais called us what? Oh, oh, my blood's boiling. Which is a good thing here. No. The first Eskimos, oh, sorry, racist, Inuits, migrated from Asia across land masses that are no longer there, and they settled in the polar regions of northern Canada, Siberia, and Greenland. And when they got there, and the one in front went, this is all right, isn't it? Mm. Why didn't the one at the back go, what? Should we settle here? Forever? Are you serious? Yeah, why not? Because I'm fucking freezing. Let's keep walking, let's find a tree. Fucking hell. But the scary statistic that I've heard about the erosion of this planet in recent years is that by 2030, there'll be no fish in the sea. According to a CNN report, best estimate, no fish by the year 2030. And I blame Comic Relief. Remember that stupid slogan they came up with? Give a man a fish, and he'll eat for a day. Give a man a fishing rod, and he'll go fucking mental, won't he? Another one. Give me that. Give him a fish, greedy bastard. Comic Relief. Not a year goes by where Richard Curtis doesn't call me up and go, oh, Ricky, Africa's still the poorest place on the planet. It's riddled with AIDS and famine. It's war-torn. Would you like to go there? No, it sounds fucking awful. You're really not selling it to me, Richard. Once he's called me, and it wasn't about that, he offered me a part in The Vicar of Dibley. And I said, tell me about this Africa trip again. Oh, she started it. It's not a disease. When I first got famous, I knew that if I put myself in the office, as opposed to just stayed behind the scenes, my life would change, but I wanted people to know it was an upshot of what I did. Fame wasn't the driving force, that the work was, and I didn't want to be lumped in with those celebrities that do anything to become famous. Do you know what I mean? And I was very prickly about the whole subject, and one of the first interviews I did after The Office broke in about 2001, the journalist really rubbed me up the wrong way with this question. She said, so what advice would you give to anyone else who wants to become famous? And I went, I'd tell him to go out and kill a prostitute. Which I thought was a really clever answer. She looked at me like I was mental. And I didn't do this bit in Ipswich. A local paper called me from Ipswich and she went, are you worried about offending people? I went, well, yeah, because it's not the point of what I do. And she went, no, but the joke's about the Ipswich murder. I went, it's not a joke about the Ipswich murder. That's a true anecdote. I really said that to a journalist, and it happened 6 years before the Ipswich murders, which ruined her angle a little bit. And she actually went, oh, did you hear about the Ipswich murders, and that's what reminded you? Oh, no, it's nothing to do with murder. It's a slight on fame. It's like going, well, if you just want to become famous, do something horrendous. That was, and I explained it to her, and she went, oh, well, thanks very much. So the next day, she went with a headline, Ricky Gervais apologises for sick joke. I thought, what are the rules? I've explained it to her, and she does these vox pops and this whole sort of string of Chinese whispers. Oh, that's racist. I'm so sorry about this. I don't know what's come over me. Suggesting that Chinese people can't whisper. Sorry about that.
That would be a strange racial trait, wouldn't it? Bigots getting hold of that one, going,
the trouble with the Chinese is they can't fucking whisper.
What?
They can't whisper. Of course they can. They can't. The Chinese cannot whisper. Watch this. Chang, whisper to me. Hello! Oh, for fuck's sake. Shouting hero must be racist. Come on. On the same day, The Sun published a picture of Jade Goody with the caption, racist scum. They published a picture of that Chinese snooker player with the caption, pot noodle. But when the journalist said to me, oh, what advice would you give to become famous? And I go, I tend to go to prostitute. It's meaning, look, if you think that's all you care about, just being famous, you can do something terrible if that's the only aim. Serial killers want to become famous. The way it's going, where people do anything to be famous, I can imagine people at home now reading the paper going, this rapist is getting a lot of column inches. Do you know what I mean? Where will it end? Have you seen those adverts on telly for rape? Not adverts for rape, not... Starts 10 a.m, everyone must go. No, it's... It's two blokes, and one of them's bragging. He's going, yeah, got off with a lovely bird the other night. We was kissing and cuddling. Then it got a bit more serious, and I shoved her down onto the sofa, and he morphs, and he's in court. And the voiceover goes, if you don't get consent, you could go to prison for rape. What sort of society has to remind someone not to rape? Was there people going, just off out raping, mum? Oh, no, remember? Remember the advert? What? You can't rape. I can't what? You can't rape. I can't what? Whose idea was that campaign? Going, we got to remind them. Was there people in court with the judge going, why did you rape her? I forgot.
You'd forget your head if it wasn't screwed on. Get out of here, scamp.
Have you heard those local radio ads on a similar subject? It's a quiet street, sound of stiletto heels, and a car goes, mmm. And he goes, need a lift, darling. And the voiceover goes, if you want to know the price of an illegal minicab, just ask a rape victim. Don't.
Worst advice I've ever had.
No, it really winds them up, because it brings back terrible memories. So I don't want you to make the same mistake I did. I just burst into an incident room and went, how much to house loan? She went, whoo, so really irresponsible advertising. Like that one, hit me at 30 miles an hour and there's an 80% chance I'll live. Encouraging gambling. I like those odds, but don't. It's... Socrates said that fame is the perfume of heroic deeds. Fame is the perfume of heroic deeds. Well, it probably was back then. There was no Heat magazine and Big Brother. You actually had to do something to become famous. You were a great scholar or a leader of men. And all the way through history, that was the case. 500 years ago, the most famous man on the planet was Leonardo da Vinci because of all the great things he did. He was a painter. He was an inventor. Oh, go on, mate. Sorry. I can't do one-on-one. It's a big place. In a much smaller room, I'd still ignore you, cunt. Shush. Yeah, Leonardo da Vinci. It really annoys me when you hear these people go, you know Leonardo da Vinci? Yeah, he invented the helicopter. No. Yeah. 500 years ago, he invented the helicopter. No, he didn't invent the helicopter. Doing a sketch of something and going, this'll fly, isn't inventing anything. I think back then he'd have folded under questioning him. So I go, wow, how should it fly exactly? Sir Isaac Newton, most famous man in his day because of all the great things he did. The laws of motion, discoverer of gravity.
I was talking to Carl Pilkington. Yeah, he's a different sort of genius to though. And we got onto science and stuff, and he was going, who's the best, who's this and that? And I said, well, I suppose Isaac Newton's genuinely considered the father of modern physics. And he went, what was so good about him? And I went, well, he did the laws of motion. Whew. I went, he discovered gravity. Carl went, what? I went, he discovered gravity. Carl went, it wasn't a problem. I went, what? He went, we weren't all floating about, were we? I went, no, but, no, listen. No, the story goes, Isaac Newton was sitting under a tree one day, and an apple hit him on the head, and Carl went, why wasn't he at work? On the subject of fame, right? Did you see Celebrity Love Island last year when Bianca Gascoigne said her all-time hero was Callum Best? And we were talking about this the next day with Carl and my other friend Glyn, and Glyn went, Callum Best? But he's only famous because of who his dad was. And Carl went, yeah, but you could say the same about Jesus.
Fucking hell.
He's got a head like a fucking orange. Oh. But nowadays, you can become famous for nothing, really, just being famous. You can just go on you can go on Big Brother and be famous. But for what? Well, Kinga, she's famous because in front of 56 cameras on national television, she shoved a wine bottle up her vagina. What do her parents think? When the neighbours came round the next day and went, saw your Kinga on telly last night. Oh yeah, what was she up to? She was up to the fucking label. Nadia, first transsexual winner. That record's safe, I think. She went there for slightly different reasons. Hers wasn't fame, per se. Hers was affirmation, really. She wanted to prove something to herself and the rest of the world, and she didn't tell the other housemates she was born a man. She wanted to see if they believed she was a real woman. And they did, to be fair. I remember the blokes talking about behind her back one night, and they were going, that Nadia's an ugly woman. They spotted the jaw and the big hands. Do you know what I mean? It's always the giveaway, isn't it? You can have everything done. You can have all the plumbing done, electrolysis, paint your nails, and do hair, makeup, lovely dress, shopping in Tesco's, whole loaves of bread.
Hello. Hello.
Okay, now. You've done the difficult bit. Get smaller hands. Doesn't matter from where, Saudi Arabia. You know what I mean? It's just that. Well, they might be odd, but at least they're. Or maybe get one and wait for that same person to reoffend. Leave your wallet lying around the town square. Got it. Yeah. They still go with a hook out there, don't they? There must be something better than the hook in this day and age. Unless you're escaping from one old ship to another, there must be something better than the hook. You lose your hand right in the, you know what? Have a hook. That, carry shopping, that's it. You know, that. I feel sorry for Captain Hook. Because he shouldn't be defined by his disability, should he? I'm assuming his surname wasn't Hook. If your surname was Hook and you lost a hand, you'd go anything but a hook. It's too obvious. Yet they went, we're calling Captain Hook. It's an insult, isn't it? It's like calling Stephen Hawking's Dr. Chair. I think of the first sex change operation. Never been thought of, never been conceived of. You are what you're, that's it. And yet someone one day sitting there went, I want to change. He went to the doctor and went, Doc, yeah, got an idea. Go on, lose them, will you? Chop them off, pop on a fanny. What? Lose them, pop on a fanny, couple of tits won't hurt, what's the matter? What do you think? And the doctor went, all right. And you have to live as a woman for a year. You can't just go and have it done willy-nilly. You know, you have to. You have to think about it, and you come back after you and go, I'm sure, I want it. I want the change. You're going to make me into a woman? Yeah. Breasts? Yeah. Real breasts? Well, you won't have a, you know, be able to breastfeed. Vagina? Yeah. Real vagina? Well, again, it won't have a cervix. No. Take a cock, though, will it? What? It'll take a cock. Well, I'll just make it. I don't want to know what you do with it. So, yeah. No, it needs to take a fair old cock. Well, I'll leave some room, but I'll just make it. Don't tell me what you're going to do. Yours. It's, no, it's just that I love cocks. Do you? Well, yours will be in the bin in a minute. You can take it home with you. Do you think they take it home with them? I would. Pop it under the pillow for the knob fairy. That must be worth a bit, mustn't it? One of the traumas of becoming famous was owning your reputation. It's still the most important thing to anyone, whatever walk of life, in whatever status, whatever you do, owning your reputation. And I think of all those people that did all that great work, then someone just started a terrible rumour about them, like Richard Gere. Someone just said one day, he shoves gerbils up his arse. Why would he do that? He was in Pretty Woman. Would he leave the set, go home and go, oh, Julia Roberts is lovely, but oh, I shove a gerbil on the arse. Why would he? And even if he did, how would we know about it? Wouldn't you keep that pretty close to your chest? You know what I mean? What did you do, sidle up to a journalist and go, keep this under your hat? I like to shove gerbils up my arse. Nervous. Or did the pet shop man phone the paper and go, Richard Gere was just in here and bought a gerbil, so probably going to shove it up his arse? Can I have 100 quid? It's just, of course he doesn't shove gerbils up his arse. I know that, but these things go in, and I know that's rubbish. But if I was to meet him, if I was around his house, and I was like, oh, nice to meet you, and he had a gerbil, I'd double take. You... And he'd see me, he'd go, what? I go, nothing, just a gerbil. He'd go, yeah. I go, a pet. He'd go, exactly. I go, oh. But when he went to the kitchen, I'd have to check. Go, tea, yeah, milk, no sugar. And I'd creep over, I'd lift up the lid, get the little guy out. you'd have to check. That is the only way you can check, really, because they can't grasp your... It's the perfect crime, really. They can't... You know what I mean? They can't call Esther Ranson. He's touching me again, so... Do you remember the one about Mark Olman? Rushed to hospital with cramps, gave him a stomach pump, and found 10 different types of semen in his stomach. What doctor's this? I hope you feel better tomorrow, Mark. Let's have a look. One? That's a different one. Who's counting the stomach sperm? Who's got... And the rumour that went with it, to sort of validate the story, was that Mark had just taken a lineup of sailors. What sailors were these? They get out of Portsmouth and go, oh. Gotta dance. Ah. Oh. Been at sea for 2 years, my bollocks are bulging. I need a woman. No, I don't. Here comes Soft Sal, that'll do fine. But you're always in the paper if you're famous. It's never that bad. The last thing that annoyed me even slightly was the Sun called up and said, oh, we know what house you've bought. I went, yeah. I said, we're going to show pictures of it tomorrow. I said, well, why are you going to do that? And they went, well, we're going to be nice about it. And I thought, well, they could have just done it, but they've warned me and, you know, keep on side and I've got a good relationship, I think. And I went, oh, okay. I said, but don't say where it is and don't say how much it is. So I did it the next day and went, it's in Hampton and it costs £2.5 million, which really annoyed me because it costs £3.5 million. And when you put in for planning permission, you put in, what, a swimming pool, put that in, that's public record. No one told me, so it just appeared in two papers the next day, right? But even though they had the same little bit of information, they embellished in completely different ways, right? And the first paper went with Gervais is in hot water with the neighbours, right? They fear my swimming pool's going to be so big that London's going to cave in, right? The second one went with Gervais is a splash with the neighbours. They love me. Right. And this is an example of how they have to sort of like fill column inches and sort of make... It's quite sweet, really. Gervais forked out more than £2 million for the house in September. He is said to want to settle down with his girlfriend of 20 years. That's settled enough, isn't it? Leaving the wild lifestyle behind him. Now, you're not to know this, but I am usually in my pyjamas by 6 p.m. I come home from work. The telly goes on, the pyjamas go on. Even if there's company, it's, you know what I mean? My house, my rules, pyjamas on. And if we've got, you know, relatives around, Jane says, oh, not the ones with the holes in. That's all she asks. Do you know what I mean? You don't need your mother-in-law when you bend over, it's like the last chicken in the window going, he's got a tumour. You know what I mean? It's just, no.
But you don't want to throw them away. Your pyjamas, they get nicer with age. They get soft, don't they? And they fit you just right. No one's going to see them. I actually invented a game with an old pair of pyjamas with a hole in them. No, you know when it gets sort of really thin in the gusset, then suddenly a little hole appears. You get like a quarter of an inch sort of hole. And when blokes are watching telly, we sort of doodle. Do you know what I mean? I don't know why. It's sort of like a comfort thing. I think it's anthropological. I think chimps do it. Not on me, on them. I don't... No good to me. They haven't got opposable thumbs or anything, so... I have never tried to get a chimp to wank me off, so let's nip that one in the bud. And I discovered, right, that if I pulled out miscellaneous bits of skin, right... No, could be a bit of scrotal sac. Could be a hint of foreskin. You only pull it out half an inch, you've got to guess with that's the... It's called awful Jim Jam. No. And you just pull it out, just half an inch, right? And you turn to your girlfriend and you go, awful Jim Jam, cock or ball. It might be genius. I'm thinking of selling that to Waddington's. If only for the picture on the box. Of all the family, granddad doing that, the little cock or ball. Granny going. Actually, granddad could really pull it out, couldn't he? Shut up, you'll be playing it at home. Awful Jim Jam, cock or ball. But the trouble about rumour is, if it's written down, someone will believe it. You could have the most far-fetched, made-up, impossible, illogical bollocks. And if it's in print, someone will believe it. Just look at the Bible. Old Testament. Oh, that's my favourite. That is a rip-roaring read, the Old Testament. It's brilliant. I like the God in that one. He's a better God. New Testament God, he's a bit wishy-washy. He's a bit modern parent. Do you know what I mean? He's a bit liberal. Ooh, turn the other cheek. No, Old Testament God, he's like 50s dad. He takes his bout off and goes, you fucking what? Oh, you know the fucking rules. I've told you. You wound me right up, you muppet. Fucking floods. You, pestilence. Fuck off. You, what did you do? That's not too bad. M.E. I've been an atheist since I was about 8 or 9. And when I went to secondary school, by then I knew about natural selection, the Big Bang Theory, carbon dating, and the Earth was 4 billion years old. And so my poor RE teacher, I was the bane of his life. And looking back, he was a bit thick, right? He was one of those teachers that I thought, oh, fuck it, I'll just keep my head down. You know what I mean? He came in on a motorbike and played table tennis all day with the div kids just to keep, you know what I mean? You know the sort, don't you? And he hated me. He hated me because I was smart and I wouldn't let him get away with any bollocks, right? So when he said things like, and God made the heaven and the earth in 6 days, and the earth is 5,000 years old. Oh, no, it isn't. No, it's 4 billion years old. Why? How could he do that? God can do anything. Well, why did he do it in 6? Why didn't he do it in 5? Let's push him a little bit. Let's, you know. And he was saying that everything that happens, God does. He's done everything. Everything that happens, he means to happen. He's on top of it. He's everywhere. And everything he does is good. And I went, well, that's clearly not true either. Why are newborn babies taken from their parents? They're innocent. Why are some people born into abject poverty? And he went, because God moves in mysterious ways. That is the theological equivalent of going, look over there. It's not an answer, is it? We swear on the Bible in a court of law still. And if the judge was to say to you, how do you account for the fact you say you're home asleep at midnight, but we found your DNA at the scene of the crime, and you went, I move in mysterious ways, good night, it won't wash. This is how stupid this teacher was. A kid asked him, he said, sir, why do we swear on the Bible in a court of law? Clearly, the answer is, if you believe in God, if that's your God, you believe in him, you believe he's watching you, you get a guilt trip, you don't lie. He hadn't worked that out. So thinking on his feet, he said, because every law of the land is mentioned in the Bible. I went, no, it isn't. No, it isn't. He went, no, it is. Somewhere in the Bible, every law of this land is mentioned. I went, what, even video piracy, you fucking... One critic, who I know is religious, said, oh, Gervais deconstructs the Bible. That's too easy. I think, well, it shouldn't be.
If you believe in that, you think it's a serious doctrine, it shouldn't be too easy to decode. You can't do it with a maths book. You can't look through a mug and go, listen to this.
Listen to you. Oh. The shortest distance between two points is a straight line. What cunt wrote that?
He said that God is everywhere and in everything. He's solidly through the universe. And I came prepared. I thought, this'll end it. I came in like a little smart ass and went, sir, is God in a vacuum which has been scientifically proved to have nothing in it? He went, yep. That's it. I thought, well, I can't win then. So I started saying, is he up my arse? Is he up your arse? The clever stuff hadn't worked. I was going, sir, is God up all our arses? Including Richard Gere's. It must be crowded up there, mustn't it? The New Testament is founded on the belief that Jesus is half man, half God, born of a virgin womb. And I think that particular little rumour came about with Mary on the back foot. Awkward questions about the old pregnancy from Joseph. You're pregnant? You haven't been... No way. Well, how could this have happened then? Two ways. One... Oh, I know. Remember when I was washing in the Sea of Galilee and I splashed up some spunky water? No? Spunky water. What about the baby is half God? And everyone went, yeah, right. But everyone's entitled to their opinion. And if you believe in God, you're wrong. Everyone is entitled to their opinion. You never see that as much when you're famous. Everyone tells you their opinion. You don't ask, but they tell you anyway. And 99% of the time, it's all good. But a few weeks ago, I was writing with Steve Merchant, and we had a break for lunch, and we went to a sandwich shop just in central London. I got my sandwich. I was waiting outside the shop. Steve was still inside, haggling. Oh, Jesus. And I was pretending to be busy on the phone, texting and that, and people were walking past, and it was fine. They were just going, oh, it's bloke from the office. Oh, yeah. I'm going, oh, look, it's what's his name? Oh, yeah. You having a laugh? Except one bloke who went like this. I'm there. Sat. I was going, mate, this isn't the telly. I can see you as well. And he decided to come over. But he wanted to let me know that he wasn't impressed with me just because I was off the telly. So he overcompensated. So he went from Mr. Magoo to this. All right, mate. All right. Sign that for us, will you, mate? Yeah. Who is it to? Stick it to Johnny, innit? Yeah. To Johnny, best wishes, Ricky Gervais. Cheers, he went. Cheers. Well done with extras. Cheers. Office was shit.
I didn't ask.
But he said one nice thing, one not so nice thing. That's life. And I don't know him, so I had no comeback. I said, oh, I like your shoes. But your glasses make you look like a cunt. They did. They really did. And he was smaller than me. I've never asked for an autograph. I remember when I worked at the Students' Union, we got a royal visit from Princess Anne. And I knew what would happen, and I was totally right. Because I was one of the managers, I had to do the meet and greet with about six others. And she came in, and she went, what's your name? Ricky Gervais. What do you do? I'm the entertainment manager. Oh, good. What's your name? David. What do you do? I'm the bars manager. Oh, good. And down the line and out. And yet, on the day, all the women in the office were going, oh, my God, you're going to meet the princess. Oh, my God, what are you doing? Oh, God, what's going to happen? What's the best they thought could happen in that scenario? She's going to come in and go, what's your name? Ricky Gervais. What do you do? I'm the entertainment manager. Wow, this has been fucking brilliant.
Do you want a castle? Or something? Do you want...
My dad was a labourer all his life, right? And in the mid-70s, about 1976, he worked on this big construction. It was building a headquarters for an American building firm that was coming over to England called Metal Box. And it was big news in the Redden and Berkshire area because it was going to give jobs to like 3,500 people. So it's to be opened by the Queen herself. And knowing this, they had site visits and they had all this stuff. And my dad was telling me they had to build a special standalone toilet, never to be used apart from the Queen's visit, which put an extra £10,000 on budget, which by today's standards is about £80,000. So the day comes, he goes to work, the visit happens, he comes home from work, I run up to him and I go, how did it go? And he went, she didn't even use it. Got it. I think of all the labourers, they're going, she's going to the toilet, she's going to the toilet. And she goes, I'm off. And I go, no, Queen, built a toilet. Have a quick shit. Proper famous. Most recognisable face on the planet Earth, the Queen of England. Must be awful. I mean, just worrying about things like that. Public toilets. I'd hold it in all day. I hate public toilets. They're the worst places on Earth. And I don't just mean the ones in town centres underground where you have to get past paedophiles and tramps. I mean, you can be in quite a nice pub, can't you? Velvet seats, oil paintings, white wine, Vivaldi on the jukebox, oh, yeah. Good conversation. Well, of course, Kierkegaard was an absolute genius. Just goes to the loo. What the fuck? Piss, just piss everywhere. Who out there has done this? And it's an inch of piss. That can't be just drips. That would be 1,000 years of drips. Someone in a cravat's coming and going, fuck it. And so you're in there and you think, oh my God, the inch of, oh, it doesn't matter on the shoe, but don't let it go through to the sock. I can't stand it. Oh, other people's pissy sock. That's the evening over as far as. So you're thinking, oh my God, and keep your trousers out of it. So you think, oh my God, and what's that? I've got to flush that away. No chain, I've got to go on top of that. What is the, who's nicking the locks? Who nicks the locks from a cubicle to, who's so desperate? They go in with a screwdriver and go, I'm going to build my own toilet one day. That saved £1, and they're small. How are they getting away with the toilet seat? Doesn't the barman go, mate, did you come in with that toilet seat? It's ridiculous. So you're in there now, in this hellhole, in piss, holding your trousers up, got a gun, holding the thing, not enough hands, holding the door shut, and you think, oh my God, this. But you can always find some toilet paper. It's usually scrundled up into a ball and shoved in the queer hole. Who's making the holes in the sides of, who makes those? You can see someone so desperate, they've done it through the MDF with their teeth, and there's who invented that? Who went, I love cocks, I hate faces, I'm gonna make a hole, and I'm gonna sit there, and someone's gonna stick their cock through it, and I'm gonna start, and they did! How did that get around? How did people know the trick? How did they, or did someone just go in there innocently one day, using the urinal, and go, do, there's a hole in there. Probably for my cock, isn't it? Yes, it is. I don't know how these things start. I went to school with this guy, right? He was a div kid. No, he was. I talk about him on my other two stand-up shows. His name was David Beasley. He's the one that said, if you get captured by cannibals, when they're cooking you in the pot, they show you pornographic pictures so you get an erection and there's more meat to go round. Oh. But he told me a very funny story as well. There was a scandal in this sort of neighbourhood. A guy a few doors away from him that was older than him, an older boy, had got done for lewd behaviour. He was cottaging. He was a gay guy. And he'd gone down to this public toilet in Cemetery Junction, which is an area of Reading. And he'd gone into this cubicle, got the hole there, and he was waiting. People were coming in and out. He waited for ages, and eventually someone came in, heard rustling. Cock comes through. Oh! He grabbed it. They can't get away then. I guess, I've never tried it. He sucked him off. What do you think he was going to do? play London's Burning, of course. This dental floss is big.
Of course it's big.
So, he got him, he sucked him off, and when they both went outside, it was his dad. Oh. Oh. All the Colgate in the world would never get rid of that, would it? Oh. Which one of them blabbed that around town? Hi, honey, I'm home. Good day. Yeah, I saw Toby. How was he? He was all right. The admin block of the student union that I worked in, there was a dodgy toilet there. It was the second floor toilets. And you walked in there, and two blokes would go and just walk out like that. I don't know why I kept going in there. But we, as the management, decided to sort of clear it up. We put a couple of stewards on the door to try and sort of kill the scene, and we painted all the graffiti. And so it was this lovely toilet for about one day. Then a new group moved in, right? And I remember this bit of graffiti on this beautiful, white, pristine wall, just a bit of marker pen. Someone had gone in. Think of someone going in and writing this, OK? All it said was, "I fuck your wife while you watch." Interested, question mark.
No.
"I fuck your wife while you watch." Interested. Then this telephone number. Now, I don't know if that business venture ever took off, but I would love to see him pitch that to the Dragon's Den. That'd be a hell of an episode, wouldn't it? Just that weird little bald presenter fellow that lives downstairs. Can I go in? "Our next contestant needs £4 for marker pens. Remember, he must get the full amount." Duncan Ballantyne. "What exactly is your business?" "Are you married?" "Aye." "Does your wife enjoy sex?" "Aye." "Do you like watching stuff?" "Aye."
Just to let you know where I am, I'm out. I will tell you one final thing before I go. Don't worry, it is toilet related. When I first moved in with my girlfriend, 20-odd years ago, our first flat together, it was a horrible place. It was in King's Cross, and it was a horrible area of King's Cross, a seedy road, seedy block, horrible little thing. It was a rip-off, but it's all we could afford. It was one room, just one room, but it had like a little kitchenette area. So what we decided to do, we moved the single bed sort of into there, so we had a lounge, it was like a one-bedroom flat. Oh. So at night, we're in a space this big. The bed literally just fit in. I had to scrape it down the wall to get it in. And it came over the doorway a bit. And in bed, I could open the fridge. The fridge was there, the cooker was there, and the sink was there, okay? No toilet. The toilet was a shared toilet with all the other flats in the block, and it was two floors down. So what wins in the middle of the night when I need a wee? Do you know what I mean? Putting on trousers and going outside, or just pop into the sink? That one. And I remember 20-odd years ago, Jane in a sleepy state saying, "Oh, at least take the dishes out first." I didn't. I used to get hold of the bottom plate and lift them all up and wee straight down the plug hole. You've been fantastic. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. I thank you so much for... You don't get an encore in any other profession, do you? If a builder does a good job and he leaves, you go, "Come back." "What? Come back." "What? All right." Good job I left a bit. I was talking about rumour and gossip and stuff, and I don't buy into it. I read something about someone, I go, "Well, that's interesting," and I think, it might not be true. And so I never pass it on. I never pass on sort of small talk and gossip. But I witnessed this, so I think I can share this with you. Me and my girlfriend went along to the final six of The X Factor last year. And it's in a studio in Wembley. And we got there, and we were greeted by this bloke with a sort of headset and a clipboard. "Hi, Ricky, thanks for coming. There's some other celebrities in." "Oh, for fuck's sake." I said, can I just go right at the back?" He went, "Yeah, sure." Went at the back with the other celebrities. So
It was fine. We were right at the back. My girlfriend there, me was there. About a yard away, Chris Tarrant and his daughter, and in front of them, Aldo Zilli, the chef, and his wife. And they stand you up when each act comes on, and you know, and you clap, and that's it. But I don't know if Chris and Aldo had met before that evening, but they were getting on like a house on fire. They were, honestly, Aldo kept looking round, Chris was making him laugh, they were having a laugh, they were standing up, they were dancing along. Chris had his best sort of lilac jacket on, he's pushed it right up to the elbows like that. Yeah. And and Ben did a Joe Cocker number, and Chris was sort of doing the actions, and Aldo was turning around and laughing. They were, oh, bless them. And it really is live, so in the ad break, nothing happens really. The judges get powdered, well, Simon does, and the warm-up man was going into the audience, keeping them amused. And on the night I was there, he probably does it every week, but he was saying, has anyone got any questions for the judges? And he went, little girl there with her hand up. How old are you, darling? 7. What's your name? Sarah. What's your question? For Simon. Simon, why do you smoke? Good question. Yes, Simon, why do you smoke? He was going, why do you smoke? And Simon went, smoking's good for you, dear. And they went, he went back in 3, 2, 1. Okay. Next ad break, he goes and he goes, lady there with her hand up. What's your name?
Emma.
Where are you from?
Essex.
What's your question?
Simon, will you marry me?
And Simon went, why not? And they were, okay. As he was walking back, we saw Louis Walsh just tap his arm like that and show him something. And he went, what? Chris Tarrant's got a question. It was back in 3, 2, 1. And me and my girlfriend looked at each other and we thought, brilliant. Sometime before the show, Louis Walsh and Chris Tarrant have got together. Chris is going to ask a question. It's going to be a cheeky question to the judges. They're going to love it. The audience are going to love it. They're going to carry him down the street and he's going to be back. So, third ad break. He goes, Chris Tarrant in the audience, ladies and gentlemen. Hey. No, it was louder than that. I can't do 1,000 people. So he went, all right, Chris. He went, yeah. He went, this question's for Sharon Osbourne. You obviously married a very intelligent, articulate man in Ozzy. That's as far as he gets. Because Sharon thinks he's going to have a go. So it goes like this. People are looking over it and goes, you obviously married a very intelligent man. Sharon puts her head up like that, looks at him and goes, fuck you, Tarrant. Everyone went, what? He went, now listen. No wonder your wife left you, you cunt. I was like this. Kids looking at their mum. What did she? She called him a silly biscuit. That means a silly biscuit. Does it? Cunt. No, it doesn't mean that. Don't say that word. It doesn't mean biscuit. Don't. And Louis going, no, Sharon, don't. She goes, no, fuck him. He's fucking gone out there back and forth. And we think it must have been Louis' idea because he was going, I'm sorry. Like that, right? And they're back and forth. He's going, what happened to church? He goes, you bang. She was like, Old Testament God. And he was going, what's the church? He went, listen, he said, I've known your hubby for 25 years. I'm not having a bloody go. Back in 3, 2, 1. The last act comes out. Everyone stands up. Apart from Chris, who is like this. What happened there? I've just been mauled. I've been humiliated. I feel like putting the sleeves down. And that's the end of that show. And now it goes over to ITV2 with Ben Shepherd before the results show. And Chris is booked on that show and he's doing his thing. His mind's probably not on it. Everyone was talking about it half time. People were going, what happened there? Was he going to have a go? Did he start off wrong? Did she take him on? She said there was a history. What went on? What was it going to be? What? Come back out for the results show and we're all there waiting for it. I look over, 4 empty seats. Oh, fuck. About 30 seconds to go before it went live, they all came out and sit down, okay? Everyone stands up. This time, apart from Chris Tarrant, who's still like that, and now his daughter's like that as well. First ad break, Sharon Osbourne gets the mic, and she goes, I'd like to apologise to all the mummies and kiddies in the audience for my awful, awful language.
But when someone belittles a loved one, we're like lionesses, aren't we? She gets a round of applause. I look at Chris, he goes,
this is bollocks.
Don't tell anyone that.
You've been fantastic. It's great to, as I say, be in London. I ended the regional tour with a gig at the Castle, at Edinburgh Castle. I was really worried about that because it was 8,000 people. People were going, oh, he shouldn't be at the Fringe. And I thought, oh, I'm going to get a real slagging when the reviews come out. But they were all great, apart from one. I got a 3-star review from Kate Copstick. She didn't think I was that great, and she should know. She's worked with the Chuckle Brothers. So it's like a dagger to the heart when a comedy icon like her slags you off. Do you know what I mean? Particularly, she looks so like Sid Little in drag. I was worried about these gigs, you know. I thought, oh, God, I'm coming to London. And yet the first day, the reviews were great. And one paper said, the most talked about comedian of the decade. And I thought, wow. I was flat. I thought, most talked about comedian of the decade. I was thinking, that can't be true. I was thinking, no, we got him. I'm the second most talked about comedian of the decade. If they ever find a dead bloke in my pool with a chair look up his ass, I might. Until then, I'm happy with a number 2 slot. Not a euphemism. But I started and ended the regional tour in Scotland. The first gig I did back in January was Glasgow, and I had Glasgow so wound up about Edinburgh being the capital, I shouldn't have brought it up, that they wanted to come and storm the castle. They wanted to get in their cars and go and storm the castle, old-fashioned style, you know, like Frankenstein's monster. Ooh, get him out, ooh. I always think of Frankenstein's monster like the 19th century equivalent of the local paedophile. Do you know what I mean? Do you remember that name and shame campaign the tabloids did a few years ago, where they showed pictures of all the paedophiles they knew, and they go, there's one near you, and people go, yeah, there is, there's one near me, yeah. Everyone's a paedophile. There's a bloke in the park, he's the park keeper, he's a paedophile. To such an extent that in Portsmouth, an angry mob burnt down the house of a paediatrician. And they said, well, he had a plaque outside. Huh? Do paedophiles have brass plaques made?
Kiddie Fiddler established 1979.
My friend said, oh, you shouldn't start the tour in Scotland. They hate the English. I went, that's a cliche. He went, no, it's true. Also, it's true that all Scottish people are just alcoholics. I went, bollocks, loads of them are smackheads as well now. You've been fantastic. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.